This work is a joint work with a PhD student of mine, so he's still in Telecom Paris. So I moved last year to Ecole Polytechnique, and it's about one part of my work, which is on a large dimensional sampling. So I will, it will have a very different flavor from the talk given by Jean-Claude. So it's much more about statistics and probability and Bayesian statistics. So it's with no algebra, no special functions, no non-linear Fourier transform. So it will be completely different set of tools which will be used. So I will start by trying to motivate my talk, and then I will go through some technical details. So I'm not sure to cover everything. And I will then present you some numerical illustration and some conclusion. So I will start to spend quite a lot of time on the type of application we have in mind, and just to justify the type of sort of techniques that we are trying to implement right now. So I'm interested in computational statistics with application to machine learning. So as you know, that big data stuff is there. So when you are looking at big data, also people start to look at much more complex models. So if you start to have to collect a lot of data, so then you can try to model things which are more subtle. So instead of using classical, but very, very simple models, which are typical in statistics, like linear regression, logistic regression, or things like this, you can start to ask questions which are much more sophisticated and look at more detailed or complex models. So when you have a complex model, then you have a lot of parameters to fit. And since I am more in a Bayesian statistics, so it's not only fitting one value of the parameters, but trying to investigate the distribution, the posterior distribution of these parameters, so which means that you need then to be able to sample distribution over very large dimensional space. And of course, there are tools to do this, and these tools have been used for quite a lot of time in statistical physics. So for example, famous Markov chain Monte Carlo techniques is one of the first algorithms which has been implemented on a computer to solve statistical physics problems. So, but in fact, there are some special structures in statistical physics which are not there typically in when you are doing Bayesian inference, where the models are much less structured in some sense. And deriving techniques to sample this distribution efficiently is really an issue which is at the heart of many of important problems now. So I'm working more or less on four applications, and so these applications are following. So the first application I'm looking at are not exactly in that order. So I started to look at what is called the aggregation problem. So in aggregation problem, what you are doing is that you, instead of using, so what you typically do in machine learning, so you start to collect data, which we call a training set. Then on this training set, you try to estimate parameters. And then what you do, once you have estimated the parameters on this training set, then you will apply. So you have some parameters. So you have trained your classifier or your predictor. And what you will do is that you will take some fresh data, a new data set, and then you do the prediction. So that's a typical way to do. And but in fact, it's not. There is a better thing to do. And the better thing to do is to do some aggregation of estimators. So aggregation of estimators is instead of from the training set, instead of picking the best, in some sense, data point, what you do, the best parameter, what you do is that you will sample some distribution which is constructed according to some precise rule. I will not go into that level of details. And then to do the prediction, instead of taking one value of the parameter which have been estimated on the training set, you will average. You will compute the conditional expectation of on the new fresh data of the predictor. So you will aggregate the answers, and this is called aggregation of expert. But to do aggregation of expert, you need to learn, in fact, the proper aggregation rules. So, and the proper aggregation rules is a kind of posterior inference. It's kind of sampling according to some posterior distribution over a large dimensional space. So it's a first application of this. So I start to look at this to do what is called PAC, Bayesian pack Bayesian problem. So in the PhD thesis in 5 years ago by Benjamin Gedge, he's now a researcher at INRIA in Lille, and he's still working on this type of topic, so aggregation. So that was the first motivation of doing this. The second motivation of doing this is to solve Bayesian linear inverse problem. So it's I will give you an example instead of going into the math. But in Bayesian linear inverse problem, what you are doing, what you are looking at, you have data which are it was pollution data in the problem I was looking at. So pollution data. So you have a boat, for example, on the sea, which is injecting some pollutant at some amount of time, and the pollution is not immediately detected. Okay, so you have satellites which monitors images, which collect these data, and what you are trying to do is that you are trying to reconstruct. So you have a certain system which is quite complex, which is kind of it's a PDE, it's a linear PDE in that case, with diffusion and transport terms, and you are willing to construct, to reconstruct what the amount of pollutants which has been injected by the boat in that case. So that's really, you have to solve a kind of linear inverse problem, so from observations. You have a lot of uncertainty, and what you are willing to do is that you are willing to have an assessment of all the uncertainty which is there. Also, you have also other examples like in Bayesian inference for high-dimensional system. I will use this example later on, and Bayesian nonparametrics, but I will not cover these aspects. So all these problems, and the list is not exhaustive, is share the same difficulty, which is sampling techniques. On for this type of models which are not very well structured, and the techniques which are known so far are not very accurate to doing this, because they do not scale really to high dimensions. So now I will use a very simple example to just let you know more precisely what I'm looking at, and then I will try to describe an algorithm for doing this. So I will use as an example to illustrate the type of problems I'm looking at Bayesian inference. So it's my first case. So Bayesian inference for a nine-dimensional model. So I start with one of the most commonly used problem in statistics and machine learning, which is a kind of binary regression problem. So what is a binary regression problem? So what you want to predict answers. So the yi are the answers that you are willing to predict. So and these answers, you are in the binary regression problem, these answers are yes or no. And you have a set of explanatory variables. So this answer, which are yes or no, or maybe explain. So you answer yes or no to some task, but these answers, in fact, are a condition to some regressors. So typically, you have explanatory variables, and these explanatory variables are extremely large dimensional. So, for example, you are visiting a website. You will click or not click on a given link. Okay, so these are the binary variables, and you have a lot of explanatory variables. And all these explanatory variables may try to give you the, in fact, try to explain from all these explanatory variables, I try to explain the answers. So there are many, many problems of that sort. Recommender systems, of course, are very, so you can, so in the recommender system, you will, because I say it's yes or no, but it can be, it's 1 to 5, so I can do some recommendation out of that, for example, because I'm trying to predict, or I am analyzing. So you give answers, and I'm trying to, I know a lot of things about you, and I'm trying to guess, to try to interpret the answers that you have given. So here it's a yes or no, but it can be other discrete data, for example. It can be, instead of being binary, it can be a multinomial variable. It's exactly the same thing. And one model, when you are looking at this binary regression problem, one type of model that people have, the most commonly used model to do that, is to use what is called a generalized linear model. So in a generalized linear model, what you are modeling the problem like this, you are modeling the answers, the yi, are a Bernoulli variable in that case, with a success probability, which is a certain function, which is called f, so that's the f function, which is called the link function, of a linear combination of the explanatory variable. So in fact, what is the model there? So the model there is that you have n, so you have a binary variable, and this binary variable now is considered to be a Bernoulli random variable with a success probability, which is a certain function f of a linear combination of the auxiliary variable. Of course, you may imagine much more complex models, so it's a very simple one. You may imagine, for example, that you have interaction among factors. So instead of having a simple linear model Z, you can have interaction terms and things like this. Instead of having a simple function there, you can have a function which is much more complex. You can imagine things which are much more complex. But that's a basic example of what is called a general linear model. And and one of the examples which is used in many cases is you take f, the logistic function, or the sigmoid function, and so you obtain a model which is called the logistic regression function, which is is used in many applications in machine learning. And the problem there is that the number of predictor variables can be extremely large. So there are many applications where the number of predictor variables is more than 10,000 or 100,000 sometimes, depending upon the application you are looking at. In a topic model, for example, it would be something like 10 to the power 5, so which means that you have to estimate, so you have a data set which can be very large, so I will not discuss that point here today, but n can be very large also. You have to estimate parameters in a dimension which is also very large, which it can be of order 10,000 or even more. Okay, so that's the setting, and what I'm willing to do is that I am willing to I am in a Bayesian setting. So in a Bayesian setting, what you are willing to do, you are not willing only to estimate a parameter, which is typical in machine learning. Machine learning, what you will do typically is that you will use this data set and try to fit the best between quotes parameters. So the parameter beta, which in some sense explains the best the data that you have observed in your training set. But in a Bayesian setting, in fact, you have a bit more ambitious goal, and this more ambitious goal is to sample a posterior distribution, so the posterior distribution of the parameter given the set of observation. So in the Bayesian setting, what you will have an additional piece of information, so you will put some prior distribution, so you will put some distribution on the parameters, which is called the prior distribution, and the prior distribution is a way to describe, loosely speaking, the prior information that you have in your parameter before doing any observation. So there are a typical prior, for example, is the Gaussian prior. So you put a Gaussian distribution as a prior distribution as a parameter, but you can also use Laplace prior. So Gaussian prior is a quadratic, Laplace prior is simply a L1 terms. So these two terms have a very different behavior. This one, for example, has been is very useful, but I will not discuss that point today. So if you are, it has the art of compressed tensing and things like this. So it's or lasso. So perhaps if you have looked at some recent work in statistics, so L1 prior are extremely popular now because they increase the favor in for sparse solutions, which are important. And what you are doing Bayesian statistics, so you are willing to sample the posterior distribution. So the posterior distribution in Bayesian statistics is a posterior distribution of the parameters given the observation. So you apply simply the Bayes rules. When you apply the Bayes rules, what you do is that you have the prior distribution of the parameter, so it's pi beta. Then you have the conditional distribution of the observation given the parameters. So it's here it's pi beta. That's the conditional distribution of the parameters, the observation given the parameters. And here you have assumed that yi is a Bernoulli random variable with probability of success, which is f of beta transpose xi. So and you look at It's called the likelihood term. So it's a likelihood term. And now the posterior distribution of the parameter given the observation is the product of the prior times the likelihood. And of course, in order to complete this, of course, you need to renormalize that. But one of the difficulties in Bayesian statistics in general is that it's impossible, of course, to obtain a closed form expression for this normalizing term. So you know, in fact, the posterior distribution up to a constant. So the constant term is, so you have to integrate this quantity with respect to beta, but remember that beta is in dimension 10,000, something like this. So of course, it's impossible to estimate the normalizing factor. So so that's an expression of the posterior distribution, but this posterior distribution is known only up to a normalizing factor. Okay. So there are a lot of works in computational statistics on this logistic regression model, and the techniques which are used are typically called data augmentation. I will not discuss this point today because if you're not expert in MCMC, it's not really needed to understand what is the data augmentation stuff here. But the only thing that you need to know is that up to now, these techniques, the convergence time is prohibitive as soon as this is larger than 100. So there is at least one or two orders of magnitudes of. So we are willing to attack problems which are whose number of parameters are of the order 10,000 or more, and whereas the techniques which are known today are not appropriate when you go, say, 100 is really the limit for example, from the polygamma sampler. It's much too complex otherwise. So it has been considered as a daunting problem, but in fact, I don't think it's a daunting problem. I think that the techniques which can be used are not appropriate, because if you look at in the link prediction, so the logistic regression is behind most of the technique, which it's one of the workhorse of Google and Facebook, in fact, to do link prediction. So and they use really regression over large dimensional space. So in fact, there are a lot of structure in the problem. And if you look at the problem now, if you look at the sampling problem that you are looking at, so you are trying to sample a distribution which is exponential of minus u beta, and u beta in that case, which is given there, which is a potential, it's a Gibbs potential, if you wish. And the Gibbs potential has two terms, so it has a term which is a log of the likelihood of the observation, and this term is, in that case, it's convex, so it's not completely clear, but it's convex in this case. And this is one for at least for the where f is a logistic function, and you have a penalty term, which is the penalty term, which is either the norm 1 or the norm 2 of beta, which can be transformed by some design matrix, which is called B. Okay. So in terms of optimization, if you are simply looking at the optimization problem, it would be, in that case, it can be even a strongly convex potential. So it means that if you simply are willing to optimize with respect to the parameter beta, you simply have to optimize a convex function in large dimension, which is doable with even if beta is if you take the one norm there, if it's a non-smooth convex optimization problem, but you have tools to do that. So it's in terms of optimization, it's a rather simple problem. Whereas in terms, so my guess was in terms of sampling, it should not be a very, very difficult problem. And I think it's not a very difficult problem if you use the proper tools. Okay, so I will start with what I call the smooth case. So in the smooth case, I will assume that beta is not differentiable. And which means that here I will first look at the case where this term there, which comes from the prior, is differentiable. And then I will explain more briefly how you can use this type of stuff when the prior distribution is not differentiable. So then you need to do some smoothing in order to apply that. Okay, so I will start to when I'm change a little bit the notation. So now what is the problem? So I will try to look at try to sample this distribution which is given by this. Okay, the distribution given by this. So it's given, it's exponential of minus u of x. U of x is a Gibbs prior, so which is non. You don't know typically the normalizing constant. So the dimension d is very large, and since I have what type of smoothness I have assumed, so I assume that u is L smooth, so which means that I assume that u is continuously differentiable, and that this the Jacobian of u of x is Lipschitz with a Lipschitz constant which is given by L, which can be computable. In fact, it's very important. So it's very important in the sense that one of the consequences of this is that I have assumed that the growth of the gradient of u of x at infinity is less than it does not increase more than the norm of x. Okay, it's linear, it's sublinear at infinity, which is a consequence of being globally Lipschitz. So the global Lipschitz assumption is important there. Okay, and so if you look now at in continuous time you have a diffusion, so I can consider this diffusion. So this diffusion has been introduced by a French physicist called Paul Langevin, which is one of the founders of modern physics, and to describe the behavior of a particle in a liquid. And he has proposed this equation, which is called a diffusion. So if you are not familiar with diffusion, it's a kind of, like an extension of ordinary differential equation. It's an ordinary differential equation in roughly speaking, that you have added some Brownian term. So BT is here is a Brownian motion, and this is called the SDE. What you can prove, and especially because you have assumed that the gradient of u is globally Lipschitz, is that you have a unique strong solution to this diffusion. And there is, under this assumption also, what you may prove is that you have a single invariant distribution, and the single invariant distribution is precisely the distribution that you are willing to sample from. Okay, it's a sample of the unique invariant distribution. In that case, you may prove that this distribution is reversible, and therefore that this diffusion has a unique invariant distribution, and this is the unique invariant distribution is exponential of minus u. And you may even prove is that the convergence to the stationary distribution takes place at geometrical rate. So typically it means that if you will be able to sample exactly this diffusion, and if you are, so you will start from some point, if you are able to sample exactly this diffusion, after an amount of time, a certain amount of time, you will be close to the distribution that you are willing to sample, and you know exactly, you control exactly the closeness, because you have extremely precise estimate on the rate at which you converge to this stationary distribution. So you can use either you have functional inequalities, which have been used, for example, by Cédric Villani recently. Like a Poincaré or log-Sobolev, so the transport inequalities, which are based on either using the total variation or relative entropy techniques, or coupling techniques, which are more probabilistic, if you wish. And these two types of techniques allow to obtain extremely precise estimates on the rate at which the diffusion converges to pi. So in fact, if the only conceptually there is a very this is very interesting in the sense that it gives you a way to sample pi, but there is a problem is that you need then to be able to sample exactly the stationary distribution of a diffusion, which is of course not completely possible, because up to now we don't have computers which are working in continuous time. So it's we can do only discretization. So an obvious way to try to approach this problem is to try to do some discretization if you are trying to do some discretization of this diffusion, so you, to discretize this diffusion, you, what you do is that the simple scheme is to use a Euler-Maruyama scheme, so it's like Euler. In SDE, it's simply a Euler, for ordinary differential equation, it's simply a Euler scheme. So what you do is that you fix, in fact, delta u over a certain amount of time. So it would be gamma k. So typically here, the step size of the diffusion is not necessarily constant. This is why I use, and we will see later that it's important to not to take a fixed step size. So, so here the step size is not necessarily constant. So this is why I've put k there. And at each iteration, you compute a next, point xk plus one. So you start from xk, okay. You compute the gradient of u at xk, okay. And then you add some amount of noise. So it's zk plus one, and it's the square root of two gamma k plus one zk plus one because it's an increment of variance in the Brownian motion. And it has a very familiar form because if you just forget this additional noise terms here, but you simply have a kind of stochastic gradient descent. So it's a stochastic gradient descent, okay? It's a gradient descent here, okay, and on which that and you add some amount of noise, and an amount of noise which is not, the amount of noise that you had there is an amount of noise which is proportional so to the step size that you have performed. And you obtain like this, for example, if you take, I think, look at this. So if you take, a Euler-Maruyama scheme, at this scheme, it's a kind of gradient algorithm. So it's a gradient algorithm, and you have add on this gradient, on each gradient step, you add some amount of noise. So it's very simple to implement. It's more or less one line of code as soon as you have been able to compute the gradient. So now if you look at the case where you have a fixed step size, so if the step size is fixed, if you take gamma k equal gamma in the previous equation, then you end up, so this equation is simply an homogeneous Markov chain, otherwise it's time inhomogeneous, but if you gamma k is not constant, it's time inhomogeneous. So but if you take gamma k equal gamma, then you obtain a Markov chain. You can express, of course, transition probability density of this Markov chain, which is given by R gamma xy, which is given there, okay? And what you can prove is that under some appropriate conditions, so you need a bit more than being, you need a bit more there to be, I will give a precise condition later on, but you need a bit more than being simply gradient Lipschitz, you need a bit more condition, so you need to have some kind of curvature at infinity. You can prove that the Markov chain is irreducible, so it's a continuous state space Markov chain, so irreducibility is not exactly defined as in a discrete state space Markov chain, it's a bit more complex. Positive recurrence, which means that you have a single invariant distribution, and this invariant distribution, of course, will depend upon gamma. And the problem, in fact, is that you have lost, in fact, the fact that, what is your target distribution is pi, but since you have used discretization, you have a target distribution which is pi gamma, and the problem is that pi gamma is not equal to pi. Okay, so that's our problem. So when if you use discretization like this, you obtain at the end of the day an algorithm which is sampling an invariant distribution which may even converge geometrically fast to this invariant distribution. But the problem is that because you have if you have taken a step size gamma k, which is equal to gamma, in fact the stationary distribution pi gamma is not equal to pi. So it's important just to just a word is that. It's simply here when you look at this. In fact, it's important to notice that it's important that delta u of xk is sublinear at infinity, because otherwise it's important for stability. Because imagine that delta u of xk is xk square. When x becomes large, of course it will be typically not stable. Huh? So the stability condition in discrete time and continuous time are completely different, and in continuous time. In continuous time, you may have, and it's well known in physics, in continuous time you may have steep delta u, and with steep delta u you have a kind of confinement of the solution, whereas when you try to discretize, of course, if you have steep conditions, so steep conditions are very bad when you are discretizing. So in this case, if you have steep potential, it's no longer possible to use the Euler schemes, so you need to use more sophisticated scheme with which are called implicit scheme in order to preserve the reducibility and the stability. Okay, so there is one way to go, but I will not. I think it's not necessary in that case. So there is one way to go, which has been proposed in '96 by Roberts and Tweedy. And the Roberts and Tweedy, so okay, they said, so what I know is that I have a Markov chain. If I took gamma k equal gamma, so I got a Markov chain, which does not have exactly the right distribution, but what I can do, there is a technique which is due to Metropolis, and which has been later refined by Hastings, where starting from Markov chain, you can correct the stationary distribution of a Markov chain by adding a kind of accept reject scheme, and it works as follows. So what you do is that at each iteration of the algorithm, what you are doing is that you are proposing according to this distribution. Okay, so you are proposing according to this step. You obtain yk plus one. Okay, there, and what you are doing there is that you will accept or reject this move with certain probability, which is given there. Okay, but the thing is that one of the problems with there are pros and cons. So the right thing is that you have the right stationary distribution. Okay, because then you can prove that this, because you have had this accept reject scheme, then you have obtained an algorithm which become reversible with respect to the target distribution pi and not pi gamma, so which is good. But there are some cons. So it requires to evaluate two times the objective function, so which not sometimes it's not necessary. And there is a problem, of course, linked with the convergence. And there is a and which is not I will not discuss that. But in fact, these conditions are very difficult to check. So in fact, even in a simple geometry, it's not completely clear that the Metropolis these techniques preserve geometric ergodicity. And there is a third, but difficult problem is that scaling analysis suggests that you have adding this accept reject term force you to use very small step size, and in fact the rate at which you converge to stationarity are much smaller than the rate that you converge with the technique I will explain a bit later on. Okay. So now I will try to explain what we are suggesting to do this, and we will see that we can tweak a little bit the discretization in order to obtain the right stationary distribution without having to use the MALA correction. I need four results in fact to do this in order to. And the first result, in fact, I need to have some stability condition for the diffusion. So I need to have some condition which will guarantee, in some sense, that the diffusion will converge geometrically fast to its stationary distribution. So when I start with the diffusion, what I will do, I will look at the generator of this diffusion, and in order to have geometric convergence to the stationary distribution, I need to. It's more or less an if and only if condition. I need to find Lyapunov function for the diffusion. And the Lyapunov function of the diffusion, in fact, is a function v which satisfies this condition. So A, the calligraphic A here, is the generator of the diffusion. So the generator of a Langevin diffusion is a Laplacian of f multiplied by the scalar product of the gradient of a scalar product with the gradient of f. Okay, that's the generator of the diffusion. And I need to find function v which satisfy what is called the Foster Lyapunov condition. So Lyapunov is, he of course did not invent that, but Foster in fact understood that for discrete Markov chain, and then it was extended to diffusion, this condition is more or less, as I said, an if and only if condition. If you want to have a geometric convergence in total variation to the stationary distribution, you need more or less to find a function v satisfying this condition. As an example, if you have, so as I said, you need a little bit more than being to satisfy Lipschitz conditions. So what you need typically is that you need to have some curvature at infinity. These are other conditions. If you take v of x, which is exponential of u of x divided by 2, in Markov chain, it's when you are looking at Markov process, it's often the case that if you take, so if you remember px, the distribution that I'm going to sample, is exponential minus u of x. So it's often the case in the Markov chain context that if you take v of x, which is pi of x to a negative power, it's a stationary distribution to a negative power of a negative power, so it's pi of x minus 1/2, it's often a Lyapunov condition. Okay, so in fact, to check that, you need a little bit more. At infinity, you need that delta u of x has some curvature at infinity. Okay, now if you have that, in fact, you have an exponential convergence to stationarity. So you may prove that starting from a distribution mu zero, we should have there are some constraint of mu zero. Pt is a semigroup associated with the diffusion. Pi is a stationary distribution, which is a target distribution, and you can control in that case. You can control the difference in total variation between mu zero transported by the semigroup of the diffusion, so which is mu zero pt minus pi, which is less than c of mu zero kappa to the power t. And you have you have completely explicit expression. I will not provide them, which depends upon the type of techniques that you are using. So you may either use functional inequalities like Poincaré or log-concave inequalities. You may use different type of couplings or synchronous coupling, reflection coupling. So there are different techniques in order to obtain completely explicit expression for C of mu zero and from the exponent kappa. Okay. But at this level of understanding, you simply need to know that you have this type of, you will converge, so the Langevin diffusion will converge to pi exponentially fast, and you have a precise control on the way it depends, so the rate at which it converges to stationarity, and the way it depends upon the stationary distribution, the initial distribution mu zero. So now if I look at the discretization of the diffusion, so okay, I need a bit the same type of stuff. As I said, it's Markov chain, so it will be time inhomogeneous if you assume that step size are not constant. And the type of condition I need for R gamma, in fact I need for R gamma condition that, which is also called the Foster-Lyapunov, but it's the Foster-Lyapunov this time in discrete time. And the Foster-Lyapunov condition that I need is that I need to find a function v. It can be the same function v than for the diffusion, which is such that R gamma v, which is you applied the transition kernel of the discrete Markov chain R gamma to the function v, should be less than kappa to the power gamma v plus gamma b. And in fact, it's not a classical Foster-Lyapunov, so because now I have a dependency of this Foster-Lyapunov in terms of gamma, which makes completely sense, because if you assume that gamma here is taken to zero, it means that R0 means that the Markov chain is completely trivial. It's xk plus 1 equal xk. Okay, so you don't mix at all. So which means that if gamma is very small, in fact, if gamma is very small, you will not mix much, in fact. So this is reflected there. So if you take gamma equals zero, you have R0V, which is equal to V, well, it's good. And if gamma is larger, of course, you will, if you take larger gamma, of course, you will typically, you will, kappa to the power gamma will typically increase, which means that you will increase, so which means that you will contract V more. So what you can prove then is that you have the same type of stuff. So you converge. It's a V norm. So it's a detail there. So it can be the TV, the total variation norm. So the iterates of this Markov kernel, we typically converge to pi gamma at a rate which is here kappa to the power gamma. So it's a Foster-Lyapunov, but you need a little bit more. You need to be able to say it's a Foster-Lyapunov, but it's more or less uniform over gamma in a range gamma less than gamma zero, and the Foster-Lyapunov should have this type of behavior. Okay, if you take exactly the same conditions than before, you have this. So if I assume that U is L smooth and you have some kind of tail condition of that form, you will obtain exactly this type of condition. And if I add all other conditions on U, if I assume that U, for example, is strongly convex at infinity, I have better constants. So then starting from this, you may have the way you evaluate kappa and B. In fact, depends upon the type of assumption you are ready to make on U. So it depends if you assume that U, for example, is convex and strongly convex outside the ball, or strongly convex outside the ball but with bounded oscillation within a ball, you will obtain different evaluation for kappa and B. So it really depends upon this type of assumption. But the weakest condition which leads to the worst bound is that you have some kind of curvature at infinity. And starting from this curvature, in fact, what you can prove is that you have a control of the moment of V. So Q gamma here, I think I did not put that. So it's simply Q gamma. So what is Q gamma of n? It's simply equal to the product. So it's so P gamma, so R gamma is the transition function of my of the discretization, so I have gamma k are the step size, and Q gamma is simply p. So you apply p gamma n first, and then p gamma n minus 1, okay, until to p gamma 1. So it's a composition of this kernel. And if you have assumed that you have a Foster-Lyapunov condition for this, what you can prove is that you can prove that Q gamma n of V, so Q gamma n of V is what Q gamma n of V is of X, it's the expectation for the discretization of V of Xn. Okay, so it's less than kappa to the sum of the gamma plus this term. So it's in fact the type of Foster-Lyapunov condition I have imposed for the discretization implies in fact a way to control the V moment of the discretization in that form. Okay, so now I will try to explain what I suggest in order to using this type of result to obtain a very simple technique to sample the stationary distribution. And the idea is very, very simple, as we see. So what I am willing to do, I am willing to control that mu zero is the initial distribution, Q gamma p is a summing group of the discretization, pi is the stationary distribution, TV is the total variation, and I will try to control this difference. Okay, so what I know is that pi is the stationary distribution of the diffusion. Okay, and so what I do, just to explain the principle, it's not the best way to obtain the tightest boom, but it's a way to explain why it works. What I will do is that I will just cut this difference into two terms. Okay. So the first term is written there, so I just what I do is that so Q gamma P satisfies a kind of Shanman-Kolmogorov condition. So Q gamma P would be typically, so you take any N and Q gamma P would be, it's a product of a kernel, so it's it would be Q gamma N and multiplied by Q gamma N plus 1 P with obvious notation, so it's simply the product of kernel, okay? And what you do there is that you replace what you do. So here it's exactly equal to Q gamma P. And then what you do there is that you replace Q gamma N plus 1 P, you replace it by P of gamma N plus 1 P, because gamma N P is written there. So you replace it by the semi-group of the diffusion. And then you have these two terms. So it's simply these two terms, of course, vanish. So now you simply have these terms here. Now if you look now at these two terms, this term, in fact, is easy to control. So this term is easy to control. Why? Because it's exactly, you look at the semi-group of the diffusion, okay, which is run during a period of time which is gamma n plus 1 p. So gamma n p is given by this, okay, and with a stationary with an initial distribution which is mu zero q gamma n, okay. So it's mu zero q gamma n is the initial distribution which is transported by the semigroup of the diffusion, okay, and you look at the rate at which it converges to pi. Okay, so it's this term is easy. Simply, this term is simply the term that you have is simply the control of the rate at which the diffusion converges to this stationary distribution would give you exactly precise estimates of the rate at which you are converging to pi, starting this time from mu zero q gamma n. And then you have a second term to control, and the second term, in fact, controls what? It controls. So you start now at time gamma n, okay? You start at gamma n, and you compare. So you start at gamma n with the same initial distribution with mu zero gamma n, and you will now compare what happens when you transport this measure with the semigroup of the diffusion, or if you transport this measure with the semigroup associated with the discretization of the diffusion. Okay, so it's exactly this term. So for that term, of course, it's we already have the right tools to handle this term, and now we need to have a technique to control this term. Okay. So if you look now at this term, what you will have to do, in fact, you will have to do something which is very simple. You have to control. You can reinterpret that, in fact, like controlling. So if you take two diffusion, which are driven, these two diffusion are driven by the same Brownian motion, and these two diffusion, in fact, evolve with a different potential. So the first diffusion evolves according to the Langevin potential, so which is the gradient of u. And the second diffusion evolves according to the discretization of the Langevin potential, which is delta u bar, okay, which is given there. So it's a discretization of the Langevin potential, and which are given which are driven by the same Brownian motion. So what you can prove, which is it's a simple technique, it's a simple trick, is that these two diffusion in fact are mutually, so they have so the law of the diffusion yt on the path space. They have the same, because you have the same Brownian terms here, they have the law of this diffusion is absolutely continuous with respect to the law of the discretized diffusion. And there is a theorem, which is a famous theorem in stochastic calculus, which is due to Gerzanov, which gives an exact expression of the Radon-Nikodym derivative of the law on the pi space of the diffusion with respect to the law of the discretized diffusion. And it's given, so that's given by the Gerzanov theorem. So the Gerzanov theorem tells you that you can compute on the path space, you can compute the density of the law of the path with respect to the law of the path of the discretized diffusion. And it's exactly given by this term. Okay, so that gives you the expression, more or less without technical details, but you can imagine that this quantity, it's a Radon-Nikodym derivative, of the law of the diffusion on the path space with respect to the law of the discretized diffusion. So now, you have a density, so and you are willing to control the total variation distance, starting from some distribution, say for example delta x, of this quantity. So what you will do is that you will do simply the Pinsker inequality, which is famous in information theory. So Pinsker inequality tells you that you can control the total variation distance between these two distribution by computing the entropy of the Kullback-Leibler distance of between the law of the diffusion and the law of the discretized diffusion. So it's a relative entropy of these two distribution. So which is there are generalization Pinskers. You can do better than that, but that's the simplest way to do. So it's a good control because the inequality is quite tight. In fact, it's the law are closed. It's not necessarily very tight otherwise, but if the law are closed, it's a good inequality. Otherwise, you use phi. There are other definitions of entropy which can be used, but in that case, it's extremely simple because if you look at this and if you plug in this Pinsker inequality, if you plug the expression of the of this density ratio, but you obtain exactly this. And what you see there is that you simply have to control, you simply have to control the second moment of, with respect to the law of the discretized diffusion, you simply have to control the difference between the gradient of U and the discretized gradient of U. Okay, and you have to control this quantity with respect to the law of the discretized diffusion, which is very simple. So you have a closed form expression, but it's not a closed form. So you have a closed form, completely explicit bound of the difference between the discretization of the diffusion and the diffusion itself and its discretization. And the good thing is that you simply have to control these moments, and you have simply to control these moments with respect to the law of the discretized of the discretization, which is quite easy if you have in mind that we, thanks to this inequality, you are able to control moments of this type of quantity. Okay, so at the end of the day, what you obtain, you simply plug now the control of moments that we had before, and you have a completely explicit control of this quantity, depending upon. So what are the quantity which are appearing in this equation? It's a d, which is a dimension of the space. So you have an explicit dimension in D, you have an explicit expression in terms of gamma k, okay, and this quantity can be bounded with using the quantity, and L, of course, because you have a difference there, L is a Lipschitz constant of everything that I've done there works because I have assumed that U is something smooth. And if I just put everything together, if I put this thing together, I get an explicit bounds, which look like that, okay? And with n is a kind of points which I can choose. So this part depends upon the way to control this system, so it's given there. The second part is the way to control this difference there, okay? And you have completely, I did not show that on the slide, but you have completely explicit expression for this quantity. So it's in fact, all these bounds are quantitative. and can be computed, and you have an explicit. For example, you can. I did not discuss that, but you have an. It's important in our context to have an explicit control on the dimension. So there is. We have an explicit control on the dimension. And if I assume that gamma k goes to zero, in fact, with some additional assumptions there. But basically, if I assume that gamma k goes to zero. At any rate, in fact, almost any rate. But sufficiently, and in such a way that the sum of gamma k goes to infinity, in fact, what I can prove is that I can control mu zero q gamma p minus pi in total variation goes to zero as p goes to infinity. So what I have proven there is that, of course, so that's a message that I want, so the message, and I want to prove that the proof is quite easy, in fact. The message is that there is a way, so it's a bit surprising. So if I simply take a diffusion, so I have a diffusion which has a right stationary distribution, which is pi, okay? Of course, if I use the Euler discretization with a fixed step size, I will end up with a diffusion, I will end up with a Markov chain, but which doesn't have the right stationary distribution. But if I use a decreasing step size, provided that the sum of gamma k goes to infinity, okay, but I end up with my discretization. We still will converge to pi, and I can exactly control, in fact, the rate at which I converge. So it's because everything is explicit there. So I have sometimes problems to convince my colleague because it seems it's not completely obvious to understand why, if you use a fixed step size, you will never converge to the right distribution, whereas if you use a decreasing step size, you will converge to the right distribution, and on the top of that, you can have explicit control. You can have explicit control on all these quantities, and of course, in our case, I think we so there is a huge literature about the discretization of Langevin diffusion. So I should have mentioned that, but the thing that we also the thing where we were a bit more careful than other authors is the way so we have tried to control explicitly how all these bounds depends upon the dimension d, because we have in mind that we are willing to sample over a large dimensional space. Okay, so there is also results. So we using this type of techniques, you can also say what happens. So for example, you can control how pi and pi gamma are related, but that I will not explain that. Okay. I should have mentioned that this type of results, there are many, many results which have been obtained by Don Italy a long time ago, with different application in mind. There is not really with the application of discretization of stochastic differential equation, not necessarily for the simulation purposes, but he did a lot in this area. And in particular, he has obtained this type of result for even more general diffusion, but not the result before. Okay, so now, and this is more or less the end of my talk, but now what happened, so what is essential in what I've said, what is essential in what I said before is that you are, that there were no much assumptions, so, but at least there is an assumption which is important there. It's even important to have a unique solution to the diffusion problem. So is that you obtain, so the potential U was differentiable. So in fact, for example, this type of problem would not be applicable to the case where U is not differentiable, of course, and which is exactly what happened when you have, for example, so which is a typical case in machine learning, which where U, in fact, so you want to sample P of X, which is exponential of minus U of X, and in machine learning, you have a lot of case where the potential U of X is F is a nice function, okay, and you have G of X, which is convex but nasty. Otherwise, so it's a convex function, but it's non-regular. So there are many examples of this. So so for example, the famous or infamous lasso type of techniques, G of X is L1, so it's convex but non-differentiable. When you use support vector machine, which has been introduced by Vapnik long time ago, F of X is what is called the inch loss, so it's an inch function, which is now very popular because they use inch functions in deep learning also now. It's so it's not differentiable at one point. Okay, so there are many problems where you can, it's a kind of, you are willing to look at this, so you have a kind of composite function where F is smooth and G is convex but not smooth. Okay, so we tried, so it's an important problem also to have solution for this, and so this is exactly what I will describe now. So what I will do, in fact, I will use something which is closely related to what people do in optimization, and it's a technique which has been used by Moreau. It's a French mathematician. He invented that in the 60s. Where what we do is that he has proposed to do. He has introduced a kind of regularization of function, but which is in that case it's a right way to do the regularization, which is called the Moreau envelope, and the Moreau envelope is defined as follows. So what you take a function h, and the Moreau envelope, so assuming that h is convex, for example, in that case it's not necessary, so if you look at, but assuming that h is convex, the Moreau envelope is defined like this, so it's h lambda of x, so lambda is a regularizing term, and h of x is simply, you take h of y, and you add a regularization, so the regularization is x minus y to the power square, and it's 1 over 2 lambda here. So it's a function, its regularization is always below h of x. Of course, it converges to h if lambda goes to infinity. So you are solving, in fact, this problem. So in the case where h is convex, so h of y plus 1 over 2 lambda x minus y square, in that case, is strongly convex, so he has a single optimum. So in this case, you may define h lambda of x, which is h lambda of x, which is the Moreau envelope. Otherwise, it's a bit more complex to define, but it's not needed at that point. The Moreau envelope is characterized. So the point at which the minimum of this term is achieved is called the proximal term. And so it depends upon h and x, okay, which is characterized by this quantity, which is a subgradient of this, and you have a closed form characterization. And the thing which is important to know at this point is that for many function g, in fact, or for many function h, there is the Moreau, so the proximal operator is none, and sometimes it's extremely simple. So if you look at if h of x is, for example, the sum of xi from I equal 1 to n, so which is the lasso penalty. In fact, the prox lambda h of x is simply the coordinate ways threshold operator, smooth, it's a coordinate way smooth threshold thresholding. So basically what you do is that, what is a smooth thresholding is as simple as is this function. So it's, you put here, it's, it would be lambda, it should be minus lambda there. So you put there, so it's really zero there, and then it's x minus lambda or x plus lambda. So in fact, what is the proximal operator for this function? The proximal operator is completely simple. It's simply this. And it's related, of course. It has not been noticed first by people. If you have followed what happened in statistics since 30 years, so of course nonlinear thresholding was one of the main themes with people doing functional approximation with wavelets and things like this. So in fact, it's related. So this is related to lasso, this is related to L1, compressed sensing, so everything is related. And it's related to the fact that L1 is always behind this, and that the proximal operator of L1 is the smooth threshold operator. But it has not been noticed when you rewrite the story, you can reinterpret everything with this type of way, but it has not been noticed, of course, first in that way. Okay, so the thing to know is that you have some properties, of course, the regularized h of lambda converge to h is it's smooth, and there is a way to construct its gradient, and its gradient can be computed like this, so it's very easy in such case. So to make a long story short, so what we are proposing in a paper with Alain and Marcelo is that we are taking our potential u of x, and what you do is that we take f of x and then we regularize the convex but nasty part g lambda, and we use Moreau regularization. Okay, what you can prove, it's a theorem, but it's not very difficult to prove, right? Not completely easy, but if g of x is proper. Okay, if it's a proper distribution, exponential of minus g lambda of x is also proper. So in fact, if exponential minus g of x is integrable, then exponential minus u of x is also integrable. Okay, and we have proper control. So what we can prove is that we can prove that pi lambda converges to pi, so pi lambda is a distribution according to this new potential, converges to pi when lambda goes to zero. We have an explicit control, which is simple, in total variation between pi lambda and pi. Forget the third term, it's because it can be used to solve another problem, which is sampling from convex body, but that's another issue. And the algorithm, which is called MYULA, for Moreau Yucida, unnormalized Langevin algorithm. It's simply what you are doing is that simply you are running with a decreasing step size discretization of the Moreau, it's a Langevin discretization of the potential which has been regularized using the Moreau envelope. So you end up, what you do is that you compute the gradient of fxk, and that's the gradient. What is the gradient of the non-smooth part after regularization? The gradient of the non-smooth part given by that term. So that's the discretization of the diffusion that you are using, and with a decreasing step size, and you obtain the result. And you have, so there are other techniques, but I will not do that. Just a small illustration. So an illustration which is given there. So it's linked. It's a simple one, but it's easy to capture. So I didn't. I chosen this one because it's easy to understand. So it's the problem is very classical. So it's a very classical problem in it's a Bayesian inverse problem in very large dimension. So it's a dimension. It's a large. X is an image. So it's an image which is observed through H, which is called a blur operator. So it's a kind of convolution operator. So it's called a blur. So it's known in that case. I assume that H is known. It's ill-posed in the sense that H is it's extremely low pass in that case, which is typical also. And you add some amount of noise W. So what you observe, in fact, you observe that you observe an image Y. This image Y is a given object X, which is the image that we are going to do, which is observed through a point spread function H. Okay, and you add some amount of noise, which is assumed to be Gaussian. Okay. And what I'm willing to do, I'm willing to restore X. So it's, as I said, it's a classical problem, but at least you may see something. You want to restore X, and you add some prior, and the prior information that you use there, as a prior observation, you use a prior which is given by this. So here, delta D is called the discrete gradient operator. It's a discrete gradient operator in the sense that what you are willing to favor is that you're willing with the prior information that you have is that if you have a natural image, it's called the total variation regularization. So what you are taking an image, so an image is a lattice of pixel. And your prior information is what? Is that if you take the discrete gradient, which is you take the difference between pixel row-wise and coordinate-wise, and you assume that in a natural image, in fact, the sum of this difference should be small. So which means that you have, when you look at an image like this, you have a lot of more or less homogeneous areas, separated with, of course, with contours. And so what you expect is that you have a smooth, when you do this, you have a kind of, so you have a smooth, a small, in fact, the sum of the difference of the gradient should be small, which is true in natural images. Okay. So what you are willing to sample this distribution. So Y are the pixels that you have observed. X are the pixel of your, X are the pixel of your, the true image. Okay. So you have a term which is simply the likelihood of the observation through this model for observation, okay, plus a term which is the prior information on your image which is given there. So I use the prior, so of course it's always a bit difficult to see that, but so here it's that's a true image, okay, so look at this, it's so in fact the number of points I will restore, it's of order one, so it's two, so it's more, it's something like 10 to the power of 5. Okay, so I am in large dimension. That's a blurred image. It's blurred because of the blurring operator H, and I have some amount of noise. That's a map estimate. Okay, and what I have obtained there are credibility intervals. So it's just the only thing I can display there. Credibility intervals, I am looking at the distribution, so now I've sampled the image, okay, so I compute pi of x, so I compute pi of x given the observation y, and credibility intervals are what? I'm looking coordinate-wise, so x is it's a large vector of pixels, okay, and I am looking at displayed credibility intervals, so which are more or less the, for pixel-wise, the zone in which I received 90% of the distribution. You can see here it's the technique which is standard take something like so we have our techniques to obtain the credibility interval. So the technique which you the classical techniques which you spend more than one day. So now our technique is with our technique is something like 20 minutes, which is a bit better. Okay, Okay, so there are a lot of work which remain to do. So there are some work which has already been done. So I did not say that. So we have computer bound bound for convergence. So it is done. I did not explain this. So we have we can compute MEC. So the MSE of estimates, the deviation inequality. So we have results in these directions. So there are future work, something which has not been done yet. So partial updates. So partial update because when you are in very large dimension, in fact, sometimes using a full gradient is not the right way to do. So it's much better to update group of parameters by group of parameters. But it's not that easy to do proof with partial updates. So perhaps we will do that later. So we have to work also to include more complex sparsity inducing priors, a more detailed comparison with MALA, trying to understand why there are so much difference. We observe a lot of difference, so it's our method works much better, but we need to explain why. And also, we have to look at there are some bias reduction techniques to even speed up the convergence, which is more or less comparable to it's reminiscent to something which has been done in SDE to remove bias, which is called the Romberg techniques, where you use, in fact, the idea is to try to you will use Euler discretization, but with two different step sizes, and you will then recombine the estimate. So it is well known how to do that when you do you estimate, for example, a smooth quantity of diffusion, but it's less clear how to implement that when you are trying to sample the stationary distribution of the diffusion. But we have some results already, not explained there. Thanks for your attention, and I hope there will be some questions.
Okay, so are there some questions?
Please,
don't be shy. Okay, maybe I have a question. I have the feeling that in the continuous case things are quite clear, and whenever you start discretizing, the gates are open and anybody's trying different techniques on how to discretize and mix. Is it the case?
Yes, that's the difficulty comes from the theory in continuous time. It's even the theory in continuous time is completely it's very elegant because it's based on so you have you have extremely precise results on the rate of convergence and very elegant because there is a natural link with PDEs. So you can say a lot of things. And of course, in discrete time, it's more complex. Yeah. Yeah.
So my question is basically, let's say differently, the biggest problem is how to do to implement on a computer a continuous SDE or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
So do you think there are other ways with the evolution of going directly from the
computer to analog computer? Why not?
Because I have the feeling it's the digital world which poses all these problems for you.
Yeah, yeah. If you look at even what has been done in the 60s, people were using analog computer, but of course it's doable. Yeah. You can emulate on a. It has done, for example, in the 60s, it was used, people used analog computing to solve a system of differential equations. So it's doable. So it's costly, but doable. But the discretization is a non-trivial issue. It's clear that it's a non-trivial issue in this case. So I try to convince you that it's okay. That's difficult, but it's not so difficult. But
we have the feeling that going from continuous to discretize to the discrete case, a lot of people try many recipes. I mean, are we going to find a general framework to do it? Because I mean, every time I go to conferences and see each one tries a different recipe and says I'm going to do the Euler discretization. Another guy does type of discretization, and it can last.
No, but that in years. That. In that now, in that case, in fact, I think there are different issues. In fact, so there are the potentials, for example, which are steep. It's a different problem, so I did not mention that. So what happens when you have steep potentials? So then you need to be more careful because then you need to have a kind of implicit scheme, so you cannot use explicit schemes. So it's not only I think here in that case we have a reasonably simple way to do. Okay, so there are many other problems which are linked with how to use It's very difficult. So, and the other thing which is interesting to me, and this is why I'm trying. So, for people which use machine learning, they have already implemented gradient descent, because gradient descent is the workhorse of any machine learning techniques right now in large dimension. And the good thing to do in our solution is that you simply have to change one line of code. Mm-hmm. If you look at our discretization, so you don't have to do an accept reject step or to implement other things. You simply have to you take your favorite gradient descent algorithm and you add some amount of noise, and then what the only thing that I try to advocate is that you also need to tune the step size a little bit in a different way. So at least when I go to a machine learning community, it's so simple to modify the code that I convince people to at least try to do this, you know. And it becomes especially interesting. If you look at the literature in machine learning in the last 20 years, when people start to look at large dimensional problems, they start to look at, there was a trend to look at convex problems, so like starting with work by Vapnik, which was the first to popularize the support vector machines, and there was a lasso and things like this, and there is a constant stream of literature where people say, okay, if we look to large dimension, we should have simple models which are convex, and then they have a single maximum, and there are a lot of things that you know on how to perform convex optimization, even in very large dimension, and it has been successful. But until the 5 years ago, when the deep learning reappears, so neural nets reappears, so you are really in the non-convex case. And in fact, there is something good with this type of stuff, is that when you add some noise in when you take stochastic gradient descent algorithm and when you add some noise, you also you have a very large of benefit, because you are not a gradient descent algorithm is typically stuck in the first minimum that is looking at, that is finding, whereas when you start to use some amount of noise, then you escape also from traps. So it's more like a global optimization technique. So there is something good, and it's funny, because it's funny, not so funny, but it's funny that if you look at the first contest which has been performed in machine learning community with neural nets, it was not deep nets, but it was neural nets with architecture which are not so far from the deep nets, and the first technique which has won was a technique based on this type of ID. So it was based on MCMC, and it was, I don't think that it's really because it was Bayesian. I really believe that it was successful because the technique at least escaped from the obvious local minimum. And I think there are some other benefits, so I don't want to pretend. So I see two main points in my presentation. The main points are, first, it's one line of, you are if you are doing any algorithm, you are one line of code. With one line of code, you are Bayesian, so it's good. So it's a good message. And the second message, if you start to look at non-convex optimization problem, adding some noise is make it extremely robust, because when you start to add some noise, even you will escape at least. Look, I'm not sure that. So of course, I don't guarantee that you will go to the global optimum, but you will escape to the annoying local minima. So I think this is why, if you look at the literature now, there are more and more techniques which have been proposed, which are at least in this spirit, and we are to that.
Other questions? Yeah,
I have one from applied perspective. So I like this image reconstruction algorithm you showed. Does this always have to work on the complete image, or can this be parallelized? For instance, if you work on blocks.
Yeah, I did not do that, but yes, it can be. There are what they call consensus Monte Carlo and SIG techniques. So there are techniques of that. I did not work on that, but
it will not break the.
No. I did not look at this, but there are a lot of literature where you do sample splitting and things like this. So I did not do that, but yes, it's doable. Yeah, it's doable.
Another question, I will not go into the debate of Bayesian orthodox, but one of the feelings we have is the choice of the prior that you're doing here, which, I mean,
no.
you used here a Laplace prior, I remember.
Yeah.
What was the impact of the choice of the prior in
No, but it's not being it's not exactly this point, because when you do classical machine learning, you have two terms. You have a regularization term, okay, which is not about the prior. So you have a likelihood term. So there is a likelihood. So we all start with likelihood, and in machine learning you always use a regularization term. Which is in the lasso, it's a lambda. So everyone in machine learning is Bayesian.
Yes.
Okay. So there is no orthodox machine learner, because as soon as you use a regularization term, you are Bayesian. Okay. So the main difference is whether. So now I have a function. Okay. When you are not Bayesian, I say okay, I have a function which is the sum of the likelihood of the regularization term, and what I do, I compute only the maximum. Okay. Okay, when you are Bayesian, you say okay, I will sample the posterior distribution. So I will, and in fact, when I sample the posterior distribution in this type of dimension, what I show is that I have many solutions which are value which are extremely close to the maximum. Because the funny thing is that there is something funny, intuitively everybody knows, of course, is that you start with a problem. Is badly conditioned. Okay, so of course the use of the regularization give you one solution. So of course, but the thing is that it's become extremely sensible to the regularization. So if you just report one point, you don't see that there are many other points which are very very close, and they can be very different in terms of the solution. Which can be very different, but they are, if you look at the value of the criterion, they will be extremely close. So when you are reporting a single point, like its maximum, you don't see, it can be extremely flat, and it typically in large dimension, you are extremely flat. So which means that there are many solutions which achieve almost the same value of the objective. And you see that because people, if you look at in machine learning literature, they have a lot of literature where they are trying to optimize the amount of regularization by cross-validation and things like this. When you start to play with this, especially when you are using L1 lasso-type techniques, you will obtain many different solutions, because a small perturbation on the regularization trigger the apparition of completely different solutions.
Yeah, then the intuition of the regularization term? How do you?
You want to promote, because when you start when you have a problem which is in conditions, you need to have a prior information in order to solve the problem. Otherwise,
of course. But how do you choose it? Because you said because it's sparse, so I'm going to take.
That's typically what people do. For example, when they do sparsity, so they say, okay, I have many regressors, but my assumption is that I know that my assumption is that there are only a small part of the regressor which have meanings, so that you will use
in the
L1 or sparsity inducing priors. Like L1 is one of the many possible priors that you can use. So L1 is not, now it's not, L1 is old-fashioned, but you will use a prior which is promoting prior which is trying to promote sparse solutions. But of course, in inverse problem, you always have either smoothness, so it's in PDEs, it's more smoothness or assumption or sparsity inducing assumption. So it's not about being orthodox versus Bayesian. Huh? The problem, you cannot do orthodox machine learning. No machine learning. So as soon as you go to machine learning, is when you are in large dimension, you are non-parametric. So when you are non-parametric, you need to have assumptions.
Yes, a question there.
So if L1 is old-fashioned for enforced sparsity, what's...
For SCAD, or there are many other type of penalty lasso is a bit old-fashioned. Lasso is old-fashioned. There are many other penalties which are there is a problem with lasso. So the problem with lasso is easy to understand, is that when you have it biases the solution. So it biases the solution because if you have a large component which is there, because of the L1, you increase in order to favor sparsity. you have to increase the regularization term. So if you have to increase the regularization term, it tries to contract. So it's linked with the lasso. It contracts the true value of theta, so it biases the solution, and very significantly. So typically, what people want to do, the right penalty are something like this. So of course, you want to eliminate the small. But at the end of the day, you want to have something which is more something like this. So when theta is very large, you don't want to shrink. You don't want to shrink the large values. So when theta is large, what you are willing to do is that you are willing. So typically, the scat penalty will do that. So it will just eliminate. It shrink to zero the small values. But when theta is large, you don't want to penalize them. So there are many, many. Of course, the right penalty is F0. When you are so you L1 is a. So if you are insisting to being convex, L1 is the last stop before being non-convex. But if you are ready to have a non-convex experience, then you can go much closer to zero. And that's it.
Other questions? Okay, I have just a small comment. You have to know that for some reason, analog is coming back everywhere. Even in our disciplines, you know, frequencies are getting higher.
But that's possible.
And maybe analog will be...
In that case, it will be easier. In fact, you simply have to compute gradients. Sometimes it's not that complex. But that's a good idea. And there are many sources of Brownian motion, so it's...
Okay, I think we'll take the break right now. There's a lunch. So let's thank the speaker.